Nahash, Steel Shod. Among the Steel Shod rank and file, many things are happening. They're all roughly simultaneous, so I'll start reviewing them in no particular order. Shortly after meeting him, Hubert took a liking to Oliver. When he discovered the lad was illiterate, he took it upon himself to begin teaching him. So, Oliver trains at war from dawn to dusk, and then in the late hours he pores over books with Hubert and tries to decipher alphabets and words and sentences. He starts picking it up fast with a few lucky rolls. Clearly, the kid is smarter than he looks and sounds. It's around here that Oliver gains his first rank of down to business, getting a +1 int bonus. And we'll spend more time on Oliver's training in a future post. It's also worth mentioning that when they find some solitude, Hubert takes Jaspar aside for a private discussion. He prevents Jaspar with a couple of incredibly worn, decayed old manuscripts. The text within is a mixture of alien symbols, interspersed with an alphabet that looks like a vague bastardization of Goblin and ancient Sephardic or Ruskin. Jaspar realizes what it is before Hubert tells him. Texts taken from the Thaumati altar in the underpass. Texts that, according to the tale Yoren told, were lit on fire as they fled. Hubert admits he was curious. He has a few notes of his own, partial translations of the recognizable text. He wants Jaspar to take over the task, for two reasons. The first is that Jaspar is going to be better at this than Hubert. Hubert has an ear for tongues, and is fluent in many of them, but Jaspar is the more studious, rigorous, and academically inclined. And this is, first and foremost, a language to be uncovered. The second reason is a bit more personal. From what Hubert knows of the Thaumati tongue, the language can allow the speaker or writer to will existence to conform to his desire. It is a very dangerous tool to dabble in. It takes a toll both mental and physical. Hubert doubts himself. He has gone down dark roads in the past, and he dabbles with dark magic even now, for witchcraft and Vlari rituals would surely be considered as such. But when he began deciphering the Thaumati script, he felt a thrill. That unsettled him, reminded him of days past when he nearly lost himself. He suspects that the best way of studying Thaumati magic without being consumed by it is to approach it from a highly dispassionate, impersonal, logical place. Hubert is wise and clever, humble too, but dispassionate he is not, whereas, for good or ill, he knows that Jaspar has more than a little ice water in his veins. He asks Jaspar to study the texts. Carefully, of course, and to stop if he feels it is becoming too dangerous. Jaspar agrees. He accepts the crumbling manuscripts, not sure if he should be flattered or insulted by Hubert's fairly accurate assessment of his character. Jaspar is also hard at work right away with Ignis and Mucker. They coordinate with the Serpentes to acquire materials and begin construction of several ballistae. The Serpentes grant them access to a tower in their keep, and work on getting them access to the high towers above the council keep as well. They want to have some serious firepower in place when the Svards arrive. Hubert and Yoren get to work gathering alchemical supplies, building up their much-depleted stock of alchemical potions. They whip up thunderbolts, dragonfires, black clouds, sunbursts, and more. Ingredients abound in a huge city like Nahash. Most of the actual alchemical creation is left to Hubert, as Yoren is soon absent himself from Nahash on his trip to Seraph. Agrippa begins working with the Serpentes, pleasantly surprised to find that, like in Torthian's cavalry contingent, a large number of the knights have at least rudimentary medical training. They help him restock his supplies at the Nahash markets and begin setting up medical stations throughout the middle circle of the city, in preparation for inevitable fights on multiple fronts. Hrodir is still bedridden by the swelling in his spine, though he says he can feel glimpses of sensation when Drangi prods his legs and feet. Drangi spends most of his time with his packmate, or out hunting in the wilds outside the city. As much as he is reluctant to leave Hrodir's side, when Yoren calls him to join his scouting party to Castle Seraph, he gears up and goes with the others. Leon is up and about now, though Michelle still accompanies him like a nursemaid. Some of the damage to his lung seems permanent. But Leon slowly begins to rebuild his breath and endurance. going for runs around the city with his Batman. Leon has often rankled at Michel's overbearing tendencies, but ever since nearly losing him in the underpass, he has accepted the presence of his inseparable mentor and guardian. Bear, Leona, and Robin form the core of Steelshod's carousing contingent, a very important force in any mercenary company. They have frequent accompaniment between Leon, Gerald, Evan, Gwyneth, Olivenko, the list goes on. Who doesn't enjoy an occasional night on the town? Especially when they find themselves in one of the greatest, richest, most populated towns in the world. Kara and Felix enjoy the break from constant travel, particularly having their own private quarters to enjoy. The two have become quite close. Felix is now wondering how exactly Acadian knight is supposed to go about seeking the hand of an Unkari princess. Zelda still accompanies Felix almost everywhere, too dense to realize that she is becoming a third wheel. But then again, Kara is the first to admit that Zelda is substantially sweeter, kinder, and generally more pleasant to be around than Felix. So, for the most part, the three of them stick together, Felix, somewhat exasperatingly, being overpowered by the two women. All three of them will join Yoren on his expedition to Castle Seraph. Shortly after they arrived, Brother Luke was summoned to meet with Sister Rivka and the closest thing to Serpente's higher-ups that currently remain in Nahash, to recount the story of what transpired in the underpass. Luke ends up sequestered away in the Serpentis Keep for quite a few days, trying to persuade the Serpentis that the undead figures he saw were precisely what Steelshod believes them to have been. Thalmati. Alexander splits his time. Whenever he has a spare moment, he is working in a Serpentis smithy, turning more of the meteor into weapons and armor for his company, and slowly starting the process of making a new suit of armor for himself, of the same alloy that his family blade is now made of. Most of the time, however, he and Elena struggle to meet with the members of the council in private sessions. Before he leaves, Yoren participates in a few of these, but many more are left to Alexander and Elena, addressing the various disparate concerns, playing to their individual pet peeves, goals, and so on. Some are easy, like convincing Lenora Avicii that the Empire is complicit in the Svartic invasion, is likely funding it, but at the end of the day that changes nothing, and before they take the war to the Castellines, they must first deal with the Svards. The meeting ends with Lenora agreeing to approve and authorize any actions that the Serpentes and Steelshod feel necessary to stop the Svards, or convincing Lucius Cyprianus the opposite, that the Empire has been tricked by the Svards, used by them, and once Terbjornsson is dead, they will likely have to work with Lucius's contact in Kassala to help set things right there. He agrees to support them and the Serpentes in full as well. Naomi of Misvir is easily convinced as well, as Elena introduces her old mentor to her new lover, and Alexander and Elena tell the old woman in painful detail all about the Svartic war in Cadia, and what they know of Terbjornsson. Naomi has known Elena for years and trusts her implicitly. Where she was cautious before, she now becomes an outspoken ally. This should give them a simple majority, but if they want the defense effort to run as smoothly as possible, they need more counselors on their side. They need to convince the harder cells. Verne Harrington is, when all is said and done, something of a coward. He doesn't want an army to be coming. He doesn't want their age of prosperity and peace at home to come to an end. So he denies the uncomfortable reality. Elena and Alexander force him to face it, and paint a picture of a crippled Tarathia. Broken trade routes, famine, decline. The only way to resist that fate is to sink all of their effort into defense, keep a united front, get the full cooperation of the merchant class whether the council pays in coin or credit. If they prevail, the merchants will experience a boom like none other when they rebuild after the war. Verne offers his tentative support. Jeremiah of Acton actually resists their initial ploy. They play up the failure of the Serpentes, their succumbing to Terbjornsson's plot, and point out that, no matter what happens, the people will not sing Kashar's praises given his absence in their time of need. Jeremiah sees through it, knows Steelshod is firmly in bed with the Serpentes, knows that they are trying to manipulate him. Instead, what convinces Jeremiah to back the defenses is when Alexander speaks to him openly and honestly about the atrocities Ter Bjornsson committed in Cadia, his hatred of the church, and all the hell he will inflict upon the common people, Jeremiah's people. Regardless of his feelings about Serpente's power grabs, right now, Nahash needs every fighter it can get. Jeremiah concedes the point and agrees to support Steelshod and the Serpentes. Asaph Artaxerxes is an interesting case. Of all the counselors, he seems the most amused by the political machinations. He speaks to Alexander plainly. After they reminisce over their service as soldiers, Asaph tells of his past as a field commander in a Hasadian army, and his eventual capture, and then conversion, by the Tirathi forces. He's faced death, he's fought in wars, and he has served as a counselor and a politician. He has faith in the Serpentes, in the city. And if his faith is misplaced and the city falls, he's prepared to face his death with a sword in his hand. One last time. He admits he has no intention of stonewalling any efforts the Serpentes or Steelshod put forth. He never did. He's enjoying watching his fellow counselors bicker and grandstand, but he will support the defense of the city, of course. This leaves just Saraya Batzilpa. When Alexander and Elena meet with her in a pew at the Amud Kahal, surrounded by the glorious frescoes, stained glass, and statues of the great cathedral, they find that she is far less interested in the Sfards than she is in the underpass. She tells them that she has seen visions of the evil they face, of Elena's lost faith renewed, of the light of Toroth illuminating even the deepest, darkest place. Alexander and Elena tell the strange woman about their experiences. When they finish, Saraya tells them that they are blessed, chosen by Toroth, destined for great things, and they must not fear such trivial, mortal concerns as war with men. Not when, one day, they will be called to face far greater enemies of God. The experience is bizarre, to say the least, but they're pretty sure they have Saraya's support by the time they leave the Amud Kahal. Road to Castle Seraph. Steelshod. Yoren leads a large group of Steelshod scouts and heavy hitters out of Nahash. Himself, Leona, Felix, Zelda, Kara, Amos, Dylan, Levin, Anatoly, Drangy, Bear, Chauncey, Prudence, Leon, Michel, Brother Torthian, and a dozen Serpentes accompany them. They ride hell for leather southeast to Castle Seraph. It's several days out, and the weather has turned sour. Heavy snows fall on the road, slowing their progress. Eventually they arrive, but, as you might expect, they find the keep abandoned. Clear signs of a conflict, a few dead horses and soldiers leading up to the walls. Leon and Michel immediately identify the dead as Lorinet Chevaliers. Moreover, they peg them as some of Marquis Marchand's vassals, and Marchand is a well-known sycophant of Baudouin de Lafine. Inside, the dead Serpentes and Sfards litter the ground, and as soon as they enter the keep, a pit trap claims the lives of two horses, and nearly does for Yoren and Bear. This is one of those times I spoke of in the comments a few days ago, a place where meta-knowledge could be a real problem. We solve it simply. Cyril laid traps in advance, gave me a map of the area marked with the traps he placed. Once he falls into the first one, Yoren takes the lead here. He leads Chauncey and Prudence through the keep, trying to find and dismantle any trap they come across. One player makes the traps, the other player foils them. To the extent Felix and Leona enter the keep, they lack trap-finding abilities of any kind. It's pretty much all up to Yoren. At the end of the day, the variety of traps Cyril could plant was somewhat limited given his resources and the terrain. Lots of pits, a few other traps as I mentioned before, but Yoren is on guard after the first one. Though he fails to find more than about half the traps, none of the others prove to be anything more than a delay. It's clear that Seraph will not be habitable until it can be thoroughly vetted, of course, but for now they are searching for survivors. They find none, but they also don't find all that many dead. Torthian confirms that there were at least 1,000 at Seraph, likely more, and there's no more than a couple hundred among the dead. They explore the upper keep and the catacombs. Torthian tells them that more than likely, the Serpentes managed to flee through the escape tunnel in the catacombs. Fortunately, He has a good idea of where in the northern hills the tunnel exits, so they quickly depart Castle Seraph. On their way north, they hear distant howls. Or not so distant, Drengi tells them. The Orshknar are modulating their voices to disguise the distance of the howls. He says that they have been spotted. Ulfshknar are shadowing them, and they are describing their trajectory to others, setting up an ambush. Yoren asks if Drengi thinks he can interject his own howls to mislead them without giving too much away. He doesn't want to tip their hand about Drengi's presence yet, but he also doesn't want these scouts to escape. Drengi agrees to it. He joins in on the howls, guides the Ulfshknar in. Steelshod and the Serpentes counter-ambush the would-be ambushers. A dozen Ulfshknar and several Vartror are utterly annihilated when their quarry is not where they expected it to be. They hurry on towards the foothills, find the trail of the Seraph survivors, eventually find Enoch and his 1,000+ Serpentes. They are freezing, starving, and somewhat turned around by the heavy snowfall. Steelshod shares their rations, stretching the supplies in their 20-odd saddlebags out to try and provide for 1,000 people. It doesn't really solve their problem, but perhaps it buys them a little time. Yoren relies on his best scouts to get them back to Nahash with all speed. Steelshod gives up their horses to those Serpentes that are wounded, or just so old that they struggle to keep up. It's a hard march, and to Yoren, ever a fan of the Serpentes, it's a painful way to meet another personal hero. Enoch must leave a few of his old, infirm, and wounded Serpentes dead in the snow as they travel. In the back of each of their minds is one simple question. Will they return to Nahash before the Svards arrive? Or will they find an army between them and the city walls? Thank you for tuning in to Steelshod, a series by Mostly Writes, narrated by Taleforge. You can find every chapter in text format, as well as character sheets, setting information, maps, and rule documents on the Steelshod tabletop system in the link below. If you'd like to support the channel, you can pop down to the description and use the Patreon link for recurring donations, the PayPal.me link for one-time donations, the Teespring link for shirts with the incredibly cool background art by Nobody, or use the DryThruRPG affiliate link the next time you're looking to try a new system. If you'd like to support the author, you can find Steelshod merch on the MostlyWrites.com store, or donate to the Mostly Writes Patreon, which are both linked on reddit.com/r/mostlywrites down below.